And we're back, ladies and gentlemen, live on the Philippe Matthew Show. Thank you for tuning in wherever you are around the world. A big show today, a big show that I think is going to have a huge impact on black men particularly. It's going to have longevity in terms of healing. We're going to be talking to Warren Northern today about how he has taken this amazing work. He sent me a book, and I'm going to have him tell the story in a minute, but he sent me a book called The 12-Step Recovery Guide for Men of African Ancestry. And as you probably know, I get a lot of books from people all around the world, literally. And I basically am backed up about maybe 2 years of getting back with people. And it literally took me a year to get back with Warren. I remember one night I sat down, and I had the book. I have a stack of books that I need to get to. This was one of them. Picked up the book, and I literally could not put it down. I had to read it from start to finish. I was up all night. I was so excited. It changed my life. And so I called him. I reached out to him, and here we are. So with a formal introduction, Warren Northern entered the world of recovery in 1993, having little or no idea what to expect. At some point, he began to connect with aspects of recovery outside of the realm of 12-step program literature and connected his past and present experiences within his culture, particularly men of African ancestry. Soon thereafter, he authored the book, 12-Step Recovery Guide for Men of African Ancestry. And today, we're going to discuss spiritual principles, concepts, and exercises for mental, emotional, spiritual, psychological, and historical maturity. Welcome, Warren. Welcome, my brother.
Thank you, Philip, for having me on your show. It's really a pleasure. And as I said to you earlier offline, I am really pleased that you took the time to read this book. I looked at the work that you do, and I'm extremely proud of the things that you are doing in your own program. So it's a pleasure and an honor to be here today.
Thank you. Thank you for that. Now, I remember when we first talked, you said, how did you find out about my show?
I was looking online, and as I normally do, look for interesting articles, information, and I came upon an interview that you had with a young lady. I cannot remember her name, but you kept mentioning things about epigenetics. I saw in your show topics on epigenetics, and that intrigued me. I read a book, I think I mentioned to you, The Biology of Belief, and about epigenetics, which blew me away. And as I suggested to you in our initial conversation, there were so many things about epigenetics that I had connected to intuitively in the process of compiling and formulating and writing this book without knowing what epigenetics was. That blew me away, the introduction. And then to see that you had it all over the place on your show, people about epigenetics, I got to get in touch with this guy. And so that's how it started.
That's amazing. Well, epigenetics and genetic memory just absolutely fascinated me, just like it did with you when I first found out about it, and how that can have, and I said, well, if our DNA can be turned on and turned off by these epigenetic tags and affected by three generations prior to my arrival on the planet,
right,
well, then it would make sense that racism would being born in racism would have some type of genetic effect on how I navigate throughout my life.
Absolutely.
And so when I read your book, it was just another level of confirmation, particularly as it relates to a brother doing this deep work.
Right.
And also what you did in terms of connecting it to the 12-step program. Now, throughout the book, and in the beginning of the book, you kind of set the tone. And you use this acronym RIWS, which stands for Racist Institution of White Supremacy.
Yes,
love that. Talk to us about how you made the connection between 12-step and RIWS.
All right. Before I do that, I want to do one minor disclaimer for the audience. I am not a spokesman for, nor am I speaking for any other 12-step program outside the 12-step recovery guide for men of African ancestry.
Excellent. Absolutely. Thank you for that caveat.
Yes. And also to answer the question, when I started on this journey, most people have a conception about 12-step programs as if it's always related to chemical addiction and so forth. And there is, absolutely. But it's not the chemical addictions per se. It's the why of the chemical addiction. See, we pick up and start doing things to mask how we really feel or not feel and what's going on in our lives on the real side of things. And we never learn how to address those problems. We weren't given the coping skills and the living skills in order to help ourselves work towards healing. Now, even when that does happen, it happens almost inadvertently, but I made the connection going through the 12 steps. I looked at this simple list, like, what is this gonna do for me really? And I knew why I was in a 12-step program, so I started to explore it and go through the process. You have to look at it. For example, the first step is we admitted we were powerless over whatever you want to put in that line and our lives have become unmanageable. Well, that's kind of an antiquated statement, but the point is when you start looking at breaking that down, what is an admission? An admission is something that you have to confess to yourself. You have to be completely gut level honest with yourself when you're making an admission. Now, I'm not making that admission to you or other people. I'm making it to myself. Mm-hmm. That is the clarity about what self-honesty is. So you are coming to terms with whatever issue or ordeal or circumstance that you're dealing with. And that opens self up to being vulnerable to self. So in the process of going through my own personal step work, I began to connect with causality, not blame, but causality, why these things happen. And then causality began to have this reverberating, rippling effect throughout my life and throughout the things that had happened to me, the things that my subconscious recorded, all of these other things. And I began to see oppression and racism in our choices or my choices about why I did things, why I wore masks, why I pretended to be, all of these other things. Racism was at the core. I don't care where I started. If I looked at my own family dynamic, I began to see the light skin, dark skin kind of components in our lives and how we do things, how we evaluate one another. And there's a concept that I'll come back and talk to as well called counterfeiting that I talk about in the book, how we take the same things that are happening to us and in turn counterfeit that same behavior towards each other. But it came from the racist institution of white supremacy and how they say that we're inferior, unintelligent, and all of these other things that happen. So that was the correlation and the connection.
You know, that is so powerful and so true. I was recently, I was recently in your neck of the woods in Chicago. Mm-hmm. And I was there with another group of brilliant minds in the Mind Body charity. And I was looking at the Salvation. I was looking at all of these black men mm-hmm. who were in some level of recovery. Yeah. And it just floored me because it was so many. And all I could think of is that the reason, the number one reason that they are here is not because of their addiction. The reason that they're here is because of racism.
Right.
Being born into that from an epigenetic perspective as well. So it's two phases. It's one that you already are being predisposed genetically in the womb.
Right, exactly.
From the three generations prior to of that black family, and that black lineage, and that's never been healed. And then you're born, and then you're constantly reinforced mm-hmm. With racism from childhood to death. Right. And everybody deals with it in a different way. Right. And in some ways, it's, you know, I remember saying to the group, I said, you know, how many by a show of hands ran up to your mother and father when you were a kid and say, Mom, Dad, when I grow up, I want to become an alcoholic. I want to become addicted. Right. It's never a goal. It's something that happens as a means of escape.
Right.
or as a means of trying to numb the feelings of disappointment, of anger, of rage, of having questions that you're constantly asking and never getting an answer to, being berated by not only the white supremacy, but by what white supremacy has done to your family, your friends, relationships, how you're treated. All of that just absolutely makes you crazy. And as a result, you say, okay, you know, I'm going to choose a bottle. I'm going to choose a needle. I'm going to choose whatever the, you know, I might choose, it might be sex. It might be a sex addiction. It might be food addiction. It might be all kinds of various different aspects of addiction. So it's not just substance abuse, but we, most of us are addicted to something, trying to escape it, trying to numb it. And, you know, the weekend is not enough. So speak to us about that.
Well, you know, you mentioned an interesting dynamic in the womb, for example. Now, talking about it, now that we are aware of what epigenetics is, and as you mentioned, three generations out, naturally, in the womb, the embryo, the child, the person, however you want to term that, is already influencing and listening to and interpreting reality while they're in the womb. They have, we have, a natural, organic, intuitive connection to what was happening in that insulated environment and what was happening outside. In fact, the mother could send signals to the child that this was happening and there was trauma, and the infant or the child responded in the womb. And so that speaks to two things. One, even as a child in the womb, we had a language, even though it was the language we have, we had a vocabulary that was composed of emotions and feelings. So we were able to interpret even in that environment. We've seen studies where babies in the womb were smiling, that kind of thing. So you have all of these things happen that were really spiritual in nature when you think about it. No vocabulary, but I can respond to stimuli that happens to me through chemicals and otherwise.
Absolutely.
So the thing is, we have to get back to a place where we understand where we came from, these influences externally. How do we heal ourselves? How do we get to a place? I'm not talking about going back to infancy or going back into the womb. I'm talking about the process of recovery is an inside job, for example. So the first thing that we really have to understand is that going through a 12-step program, there are so many organizations that emulate it and discredit it at the same time. They'll take tools of what 12-step programs do and then talk about the other parts of it that I don't like. Well, recovery sends you on the inside to look at your life, not my life, not somebody else's life, but your own life. And you take these tools with you when you go inward and look at your past. You look at your present. You look at your reaction to the past, and all you're required to do is take the right tools with you. One of them is self-honesty. You have to practice that. You don't get to that place without practicing how to be honest with yourself. But once you start on that journey, you begin to find out things about who you are, why you responded, why you reacted to life, these kind of stimuli, positive and negative ones.
Absolutely. So,
the racist institution, white supremacy, we've always been reactionary rather than learning that, one, I wasn't made inferior. Mm-hmm. I was told that. And so as a result of that, I acted that way. Then you go back to some of the things that happened in my own studies, for example, you look at what IQ is and psychometrics and how they determine what is, who is intelligent. You look at the body of data that's out there. And so even in the educational paradigm, we accepted that we were inferior subconsciously because that's what was presented to us. It was like 50 years later before we found out, for most of us who did the research, we found out that most of the information that was fabricated, it was distorted.
Absolutely.
It wasn't based in real and reality. And epigenetics turned that whole dynamic on its head.
Yeah, it did. It really did.
It turned it on its head. So environment being the greatest influence, we still have the opportunity to go inward and look at ourselves and examine ourselves and change ourselves, even at the molecular level.
And, you know, what you just said is so powerful. And I really want my brothers to hear this and my sisters, too. that, and I you know, I had Dr. Edwin Nichols on, who is the creator of the philosophical aspects of cultural difference, and he's been doing he's been in philosophy and the sciences for 50 years, and we talked about epigenetics on that show. And what was powerful at the end of the close to the end of the show, he said it would only take one generation to turn it completely around. Just one generation. You know, sometimes we sit and say, well, how are we ever going to get out of this situation? And we have the power because of understanding, a deeper understanding of epigenetics, how to apply it. And I think your work is going to be pivotal in doing that, that one generation.
Yes.
We can completely heal ourselves from what Dr. Joy DeGruy calls the post-traumatic slave syndrome, the genetic memory of three generations of what you call the racist institute of white supremacy. And that is a very powerful thing. And it makes me very pleased to know that we don't have to do this for another 400 years, or it's going to take that long to turn it around.
Right, exactly. And one of the revelations that came to me was, once I started going through this journey, I began to realize, you know what? Racist institutional white supremacy is not a black invention. It's a white invention. We have to accept that. We don't take responsibility. All those things that happened to us as a result of the racist institutional white supremacy, the oppression, the suppression, the marginalizing, all of those things, that's not our fault. Once we learn not to take responsibility for it, because we are bombarded. The other thing that I wanted to do is to try to normalize what 12 steps really are, for example, move people away from the dynamic that's got to be a chemical so I don't fit in kind of the thing. The cliche, or one of the things I use, perhaps the first and most ubiquitous narcotic on the planet is propaganda.
Wow. Come on with it. Come on with it, Warren. There it is.
No one is free from its influence, not even the dead or the unborn. So once you understand that we're all impacted and affected by the propaganda, and that's what it really is. When you start telling people they're marginalized, they're inferior, and it's not based in science, it's a political construct that they use to bend your mind and influence perception management and perception bending kind of a thing to get you to accept. And even though we say, oh, no, that's not the case, our behavior says something different. So at some point in the journey, we bought into that. We bought into the inferiorization. We bought into secondhand citizenry and all that kind of stuff. And we moved ourselves away from our real humanity. That's what we've lost. I look at the history of what all of those ancestors and all of those predecessors that came before us that left this massive legacy. They made all kinds of sacrifices, martyrdom, employment martyrdom, all this economic martyrdom. They went through so many different things. They challenged throughout their lives while they were here the whole premise of what inferior, what that means to us, and we're not, you know, they put all of this work, they didn't do all of that just so that we could end up parroting and paraphrasing and quoting. They wanted us to take this information and do something with it, to go to another place. So when you saw it, and that other person you mentioned talked about doing it in a generation, that's real. Take it upon ourselves to say, wait a minute, I can try this. Look, there are exercises. I don't mean to go on and on, but there are exercises. There are exercises tied to some of the steps that take us inward. Again, it's a journey that you take. You're not taking everybody with you. You're taking you into your life and examining and peeling back the layers for why we did things, why we responded, why we did this, and why we said that. And then throughout the journey, you begin to learn how to gracefully love yourself, like yourself, and forgive yourself for the bad choices that we made. Because again, we were stuck in an insularity of propaganda that told us that we were not worthy.
Wow. This is so pivotal, because I had Freeway Ricky Ross on the show some time ago, and you know, I'm sure most people know his story. But during our talk, and I think he was on a couple of times on the show, but during our talk, he was sharing how he got involved in selling crack cocaine, using crack cocaine, and what ultimately led to his life sentence, and then of course subsequently how he got out. But every aspect of his story, from wanting to play tennis but didn't have enough money, didn't have the education in academics, was illiterate, saw his mother lose her house and all the poverty that he was living in, his friend came to him and said, hey, you can sell crack and maybe make some money, and so he did and became very successful. Then where did he get the crack from? Who supplied the crack? And all of these things. And everywhere you look in his story, mm-hmm. there was the racist institution of white supremacy.
Right. Yeah.
And so I, that interview, that was one of those moments that changed me, because the propaganda had gotten to me where I started looking sideways at my brothers and sisters who are out there either on drugs or selling drugs. And then I realized, wait a minute, none of that is your fault.
Right.
That was put in place prior to your arrival.
Yes.
And that was done intentionally and deliberately. Mm-hmm. And so some of us learn how to thrive.
Right.
In this culture. But most of us just barely survive.
Right. Right.
And so I appreciate in the book that throughout the book, ladies and gentlemen, that Warren basically says, listen, whatever has been done to you, mm-hmm. and whatever you have done, ain't your fault.
Right.
It is a system put in place for you to have to navigate. It's like a mouse being put into a maze, mm-hmm. and you have to figure your way out.
Right.
And they give you a quick and easy choice, because they take away your academics, they take away your economics.
Yes.
And so as a result, you have no choice than to move in a particular way, and the system is right there for you. I really, really appreciate that aspect of this book and this conversation.
Right. One of the things that you just said reverberated back to the early music industry, how so many of our phenomenal artists, writers, musicians, singers, and so forth were trying to do things to build their own Sony's, for example, in a time when that was considered impossible, unacceptable. And some of them lost their lives. Some of them, they never got credit, recognition for the work that they produced, the influence that they had on the music industry as a whole. You just spoke to that in that whole information you just presented. So that's what I was doing. I was connecting with different aspects of our history. We don't have to go back to ancient Africa necessarily. It's good to have that and it's good to know it, but you
sure.
connect with that in our reality right now in the last 60 years, the last 100 years, and find all of the information that you need, see the same kind of patterns that the racist institution of white supremacy put in place to move us, look, to knock us out of our spiritual orbit. That's where we've been. We've been
absolutely.
We've been knocked out of our orbit in terms of how to love ourselves, how to love one another and reconnect. And that's another thing that I mentioned in the book. I go out through my life and I speak to Black men and women. Hey, how you doing? How's it going? On the elevator, at the grocery store, in the laundromat, wherever I am. And oftentimes women think I'm hitting on them. And even guys think I'm hitting on them. That's not the case. I'm trying to do something in the way of living what I say I want to be about. There were periods in our lives that we spoke to one another. Hey, what's happening? How you
That's
doing?
True.
We don't do that anymore.
That's true.
Shame associated with recognizing each other and our humanity.
Wow.
Has put us in place where, oh, we don't want to recognize each other. That speaks to self-destructive, self-hatred, those kind of things. And we are going about the task of continually injuring ourselves or disconnecting and not realizing that what we're doing is counterfeiting or expressing the racist institution, white supremacy, by disconnecting from one another. That's what we're doing. And we need to learn that we don't have to do that anymore. It's okay to speak to you on the elevator, regardless of how many other people are around, because they won't speak to us. We need to acknowledge each other. That's how
it's going. Absolutely. Dr. Francis Cress Welsing talks about dynamic projection and how we, and you're right, we have now taken on this ideology, this propaganda of the racist institution of white supremacy. And so now we treat each other like we don't like each other. Like, you know, I don't like you because you black too. It's like, it's absolutely crazy how we have internalized this. Now, Professor Kabahiel Wasakamane, who you know, we had him on the show yesterday, he's a regular on the show. He talks about how we were taken from our spiritual destination. You talk about the spiritual orbit. We were rude, as he uses the quote, we were rudely interrupted. I love that. We were rudely interrupted. And as a result of that, he also says that you know, when you are placed in an unnatural environment,
yes,
he says it is natural for you to act unnaturally.
Yes, absolutely.
And so I agree with you 100%. And you talk about this throughout the book, and that's one of the premises of the book is that, you know, hey, you're around and were born around sick people.
Yes.
So you might not think it or know it, but you probably sick too.
Yes.
But you're not sick because you are sick. Right. You are sick because you are associated and around
the
sickness and the illness. Yes. You are okay. And that is what I think black men, we need to hear that, we need to know that, we need to internalize that, we need to own it, that we are okay. It's that the environment, I call it the slave ship America, this slave ship called America, that is constantly producing propaganda.
Yes.
That is showing us the worst of ourselves that we are internalizing and then now giving it back to our own community.
Absolutely. As a matter of fact, you touch on a great many things. One of them is, I talk about in the book the drunkening, if not hypnotic, insularity of propaganda. It's around us 24/7. It's at it's on the elevator. It's at the gas station. It's on all of the media outlets. It's been that way, and it has evolved. So it's not a question of just. We still need to look at what is propaganda, but we need to also examine where is propaganda and all of its influence and tie that into, as I mentioned earlier, mind control, perception bending, and all of these things. So we begin to recognize where it is and how it's influencing us. That alone, that awareness itself helps us to begin the separation from taking all of this stuff. They'll bombard us with it. I mean, we're so bombarded with it, it's in our dreams.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Very, very good point. I have a feeling this show is going to go viral because this is a show that every black man and I believe every black woman, particularly single mothers raising black men, need to hear, need to see, need to know, and need to share this. And we're going to welcome your comments, obviously, after the show. But what I want to ask you now, what I want to talk about is, you know, this understanding, this aspect of racist institutes of white supremacy. In the book, you did an amazing job at putting humanity, if you will, into these child groups.
Right.
And I thought, I had to literally, it was like 12 midnight. I'm making a cup of coffee reading this book. I'm like, this is incredible. Walk us through. These child groups and the characteristics and traits of these child groups and how they all connect to the racist institution of white supremacy and how it continuously tries to paint this picture of black men and black people.
Right. Let me start off with, you look at, as I mentioned, history, you look at parts of what happened in this country. There were periods when other groups outside of Europeans and black people had a cordial relationship, a respectful relationship. We interacted with one another. We shook hands. We had camaraderie. We had rapport. poor and all of that. And then suddenly white supremacy realized, whether inadvertently or otherwise, that, wait a minute, we can't have these people connecting with all of the other people. See, I think that when I put that in play, I was dealing with how family groups, for example, child family groups, how you look at, there was a one of the poems I said in the book about the anti-color is black, not cashew, brown, peanut, but black from the equator and black and back. Now, the point in that whole dynamic or poetry was basically to point out that black is the anti-color on the planet, no matter where you go. So black people with straight hair were identifying with white people because they had straight hair. And so white supremacy has a tendency to embrace everybody else other than black people who have dark skin and kinky hair kind of thing. So they began to politically, again, it's a political construct, ingratiate everybody else, move them. You're in favor with us as long as you don't like them people.
That's
the dynamic that started to happen over a number of years. And then suddenly you find that everybody hates us in the same way that white people hate us. Not because we did something wrong to them, but we are the anti-color. And that's why I put the family groups together, because we don't have relationships with other groups. And I put them in three classifications. The European being the one, and everybody else trying to move up to being that, how do I graduate to get to being in class one with everybody else? And then those other people who might be slightly darker, but got straighter hair, or come from another part of the world, that was the second group. But they emulate the same thing that group one did. You have to hate these people in order to be a part of our group, that kind of thing. And then basically we end up on the bottom of it because we are dark in skin or kinky hair, or, you know, all of those dynamics. So that's why I put that into that format.
Thank you for that. You also say that we must unapologetically resurrect and reconstruct a self-education, autodidactic movement for ourselves and stick with it. I remember you, I think you saw the show I did with Dr. Luann Brizendine, who was on Epigenetics of Poverty. And we were joking on the show. She called me an autodidact. And I said, well, you know, you can get to call me anything you want, doc. Just don't call me late for dinner. But she explained what an autodidact is. You understand what that is. Explain that to us as black men, what it is that we naturally have because we're melanated.
Well, you know what? The whole thing, you have to, again, look at the history of what happened to us. We were deprived educationally. We were deprived in the context. You can't get the same books. You can't have access to the same professors. You cannot have access to the same corridors that other people went to. And so every time we were in an educational paradigm, we always had to do extra work if you wanted to excel. So that meant for those who were challenged, who knew that they had to do other things, we had to turn off the TV, turn off the radio, and spend some extra time bringing ourselves up, learning some foundational, fundamental things so that we could compete with other people's in learning environments. So autodidactism is basically the ability to train and teach yourself. In my case, you know what I did, Philippe? I've always loved learning, and I don't know where it came from, but I've always loved it. And so I made syllabuses for myself. I would take topics and create a syllabus and dive into it and begin to learn as much as I could about it. Because I had learned that some of the wealthiest people on the planet weren't necessarily college educated people. They were autodidacts. They taught themselves certain things. They took it upon themselves to cut down everything else and bury yourself into, if you have deficiencies and you know you have them, you have to develop a syllabus for yourself in order to overcome this, because the institutions, they're not going to give it to you. They're going to stay on pace with where they're going, and you end up getting what they call a passing or failing grade because you can't bring yourself up to speed. Well, we have to take it upon ourselves to educate ourselves, take some time away from all of the other addictions, which is entertainment and all of those other things, distractions, whatever they may be, and create a syllabus. So autodidactism is the thing that will help us get there. That's okay. It's a good thing, not a bad thing.
Wow. You know, I was the baby in the family, and I have an older sister, and I'm joking right now when I say, you know, maybe you could have been my brother, because I swear to God, you are my brother right now, because it's like I'm interviewing myself right now. This is absolutely crazy that I'm listening to you, and it's like, dude, this is exactly what I am dedicated to. This is why I do this show, and yeah, I was in special ed. Because I do now have a special education, right. And that's what we all have to have. We have to specially educate ourselves,
yes.
So that we can do what we need to do and move ourselves up and out of this this racist institution of white supremacy. And I will go as far to say, and I'm going to ask you the question that it's not about. You know, if you will, changing necessarily the system.
Yeah.
It's changing us.
Yes.
In response to that system where it no longer affects us.
Yes, absolutely. Absolutely.
How am I doing on that? Is that right?
You're doing that's exactly right. And listen, to be clear, they know when they encounter someone who is not affected by the machinations that they use to oppress you. They know when they see a man like, I try to adhere to the principle of anonymity and 12-step program, and I'm trying to name drop and all of those other kind of things. But you look at this prominent athlete recently who stood up and said, wait a minute, the things that are happening to us as a people that are happening, I refuse to ignore that. So he stood up for our humanity. That's what he did. That was for us. To let us know, wait a minute, we need to send a signal that this is not right. I don't care how many criminal charges he had, none of those things that they use to say, well, it's okay to shoot him in the street like an insect. He stood up and said, this is wrong. This is inhumane, what's happening to us. And all of a sudden, people came up to say, well, he wasn't a patriot. Wait a minute. He was a human being first. He was a man first. That's the first dynamic. So did he ruin his career? What kind of a question is that? No, he stood up. If his career is ruined, the organization that's in control of his career did that. But that switch, that dynamic that they use propaganda to turn it around, it's your fault. Not our fault, not something right. that we're doing wrong. It's your fault because you stood up, and right. that's why you're losing your job. The punishment element is there all the time, no matter what. That's the punishment element.
You're absolutely right. Dr. Joy DeGruy talks about this, and when I on the show that we did on post-traumatic slave syndrome, and she used the paraphrase and used the analogy of, you know, you hit me with a stick, you injure me.
Mm-hmm.
And then you say when I scream in pain, you say it's my fault.
Right.
And then as I try to go and heal, right. you hit me again
yes.
in the same spot.
Yeah.
And you keep re-injuring me
right.
and keep saying, well, you need to protest quietly now. You don't yeah. need to go out here and protest loudly and make any noise. And by the way, it's your fault anyway, because, you know, had you have not been standing there, I never would have hit you in the first place.
Yes.
This racist institution of white supremacy is when you it's like awakening. I love the movie. It's like awakening from the Matrix.
Yes. Yes. Okay.
Because when you're in it and you're trying to navigate and maneuver in it, you think that, okay, this is just the way life is. These are the things I've got to do. This is what I've got to do to survive and thrive, boom, boom, boom. Why do I keep running up against these walls? What is going on? Why is it that every time I move forward, the finish line moves a little further away? What's going on? Until you one day wake up, become conscious, and you realize, oh, I'm in the Matrix.
Yes.
I'm in the racist institution of white supremacy. It ain't about me. It's not my problem. It's not my fault.
Right.
That's their sickness and their fault. So then you say, now what do I do now? And of course, it's difficult because your money might be tied to a racist institution. Your family might be tied to that. Your, if you are, had some level of education, was tied obviously to that.
Yes.
So it's very difficult to peel back that onion and those layers and remove yourself systematically from the racist institution of white supremacy that, that you talk about.
Right.
Speak to us about that aspect of the punishment that comes with standing up and removing yourself from it and acknowledging that it exists.
Well, again, that's why I point out we have to learn not to take responsibility for the racism, for RIWS, I call it, R-I-W-S, I abbreviate it, not to take responsibility for it, because no matter what happens, I can go any place and encounter that. I was at the store and buying some electronic equipment, for example, and it was just, it's the thing my friend called at one time microaggression.
Yes.
It happens every day, all day, in every transaction, and the bombardment of it, it looks subtle, but like persecution, if it's ongoing, every transaction, every move you make, you encounter this whole, the punishment of one, being a black person, having dark skin or whatever you are in that context, you're being punished for it just for that. And then when you go to do business or any other transaction, all of a sudden that has to come into the equation too, that you only get inferior marginal assistance or marginal acceptance or all of these other things. And they happen every day, not just to me, but to you and everybody else.
Absolutely.
We have to recognize that and say what it is.
That's it. It's we have become, I did a show with Sister Amuna Yisrael on this. We've become addicted to the racist institution of white supremacy.
Yeah.
It has become our addiction, and we have normalized it.
Yes, yes.
And therein lies the problem, is that when you normalize it, you have accepted it at the cellular level.
Right.
You don't even know that what you're doing now is screwing up the next three generations.
Right, right, exactly.
Because epigenetically now, you're creating a genetic memory that it's okay to be treated this way. This is the way it is. It's never going to change. If our ancestors of, from slavery had that mentality, you and I wouldn't be able to have this conversation right now.
As a matter of fact, you look back at what happened immediately following slavery, and you look at the kinds of institutions and crafts that we were producing back then. Now, we didn't do that alone. It didn't happen in a vacuum, but our minds and our spirits, our essence were primed for, let's do excellent things. Let's participate. Let's elevate ourselves. Let's connect it with one another. And we started to do that during that period. And then the next thing you know, what's that, the reconstruction happened and the K happened. Now, I don't know. I'm not suggesting that they were aware of how propaganda worked and how oppression worked, but they did know enough to say, look, we need to put more pressure on them. And how do we keep them in slavery, although they've been legally considered free? And they came up with sharecropping. And there we were, all over again, in the same racist institution of white supremacy.
Absolutely.
And fight our way back to get to a place. And so we lost some things as a result of this oppression. Again, the other brother said, but we got knocked out of our spiritual orbit.
Right, right.
So getting back to that place is an inside job. So I'm not trying to sell people something just to be talking. I'm talking about taking a journey that only you can take for yourself. If you take the exercises that are a part of this book, for example, and you go through that by yourself, and if you come to the end of it and say, I didn't learn anything about who I am and where I came from, then I don't know what to say to that.
Well, I would say that you're dead, and so you, if you're dead, you shouldn't be reading the damn book in the first place. There's absolutely, unequivocally no, and you know, I hate to say it, I'm sure there's a brother or a sister out there that would probably read this book and say, oh, no, that's not me. And that is the, that would be the black person that I would be terrified to be around.
Yes. Okay. Well,
because we've done shows, we've done hard hitting shows, Warren, on what we call coons and the self-hate race.
Right.
We know that those are the people who are truly addicted to the racist institute of white supremacy to the point where they will turn on their own mother.
Right.
So we understand the power of this and the consequences of this as well, which is even more of a reason why we need to stick together in these ways and communicate in these ways, have these conversations so we know that we're not alone, because sometimes that loneliness and isolation does get to you.
Yes, it does. Yes.
Because you know there's not too many people you can speak to at this level. And so you almost end up having to do a little coonery yourself just to survive each day going outside your door.
Right, exactly. That's exactly right. I tell my daughter that kind of thing all the time. You have to prep yourself. But when you walk outside the door, you have to be armed and suited, because you're going to war. Even though you may not think that they're at war that you're in a war, they're at war with you.
Exactly.
In every aspect of your life and living, no matter, even if you're in denial about it, they're still at war with you. They're still at war with you, which is why we were talking about early on, having this book helps us to create a conversation and not a competition.
Yes.
When we have these kind of conversations among black men, we think we need to compete about who knows the most in black history. Who knows more of the people involved in what we call the conscious community, and how close are you to them, and all, and it becomes a competition rather than a conversation. And we have to move away from that celebrity mentality about who's important and who's not, and stop allowing ourselves to be divided along class, caste, religious, physical, and geopolitical standings. All of that stuff gets in the way, because we're still trying to measure ourselves based upon a paradigm that we didn't create in the first place.
There it is, brother.
Our first connection is always to our indebted African humanity. That's the first allegiance that has to come first, and everything else you want to put on top of that is your choice. But if we don't recognize each other as human beings, man to man, woman to woman, child to child, we don't start speaking to one another and being able to have this conversation. It's okay to have a conversation and disagree about some things without exploding just because somebody doesn't agree with you. It's okay to have a critique and a criticism. We need both when we're talking about these kind of things. Yes. A critique is we have the ability to be empathetic while we're pointing out what might or might not be flaws or things we don't understand, and the criticism is breaking somebody down. Well, that critique and criticism works on the inside too when we do that to ourselves. Mm-hmm. So the journey still has to be predicated on practicing self-honesty. I can't emphasize that enough. You're not going to get anywhere if you're going into yourself and you're in denial facing the truth about the things that have happened to you in your life. You can't pass that and think you're going to make some headway about healing, because that's ultimately what we're after. Go ahead.
Absolutely. Absolutely. You know, as I'm sure you know, I have Dr. Jacqueline Battalora on my show frequently, and she's a professor, you know, a lawyer professor. And matter of fact, when I was in Chicago, she picked me up from the airport, and she drove me past the law library where she found, this was, I think, in, like she said, in 1998, somewhere around about where she found where white people were invented in America as a political, social, and economic construct. And I was, you know, when we started having those conversations about a year or so ago, I was blown away, because we all, you know, one of the things that we have a tendency to do, because we don't know, some of us know our black history, but we don't really know the white history.
Right.
And we don't know that how America was founded, why it was founded.
Right.
And this thing called what she calls whiteness. And so what we're attempting to do, Warren, is separate, if you will, white people or European from whiteness. Whiteness are the laws, the racial institution of white supremacy. That is the whiteness that we have to name, look at, know, separate ourselves from, realize that it's not our problem, not our fault. I even experienced it when I was in Chicago, a couple of weeks when I was in your neck of the woods, just going back there and just looking at the whiteness of it all.
Yeah.
And you in the book go as far as to say, and I'm totally a proponent of this because I talk about the epigenetics of poverty and economics. You say that poverty is not an accident, it's a prison.
Yes, absolutely. Yes.
It's directly created intentionally,
yes,
by RIWS, racist institutions of white supremacy.
Right. And you know, and it is. We look at how what they've done to garner all of the resources on the planet. They control everything. Labor, resources, money, monetary funding, institutions, everything. It's under their dominion and under their control. They have amassed this, all of this wealth that they can't spend in many, many generations.
Mm-hmm.
And there's never been no distribution of the wealth that they've amassed. Look, I say the other part of it in the book. Affirmative action, for example, is no way to consider, I'm paraphrasing it because I can't, but basically it is not compensation, recompense for all of the things. Offering affirmative action for all of the things that we've been through is the equivalent of offering a Band-Aid at a beheading, for example.
Mm-hmm.
How do you take a Band-Aid and put somebody's head back on? You've taken away all of the resources that they could possibly have. There's never been no distribution of the wealth. There's never been a real opportunity for us as a collective to excel. Yeah, they'll do one here, one there. They'll allow you to make this kind of money. And those are the people who assume that they're no longer a part of us and that you need to pull yourself up by your bootstraps. Now, where did we hear that from? Again, that's one
absolutely
of the counterfeiting terms that we take and use it on ourselves.
That's right.
For example, right. That is. So yeah, absolutely.
All right, my brother. So what I want to do is, because I really want to do, what we're going to do, ladies and gentlemen, we're just going to do a series of shows with Warren, because I know you guys out there, you comment all the time. We chat on the YouTube channel. We're on Facebook together. And so I know that these shows are making a difference. They're resonating with you. And so my goal is to try to bring you, you know, the most accurate, immediate information that you can apply in your life right now. And so I don't want to gloss over the significance of this work and the significance of what Warren has accumulated and amassed in this work. The book is in pre-order, so you can't get it yet on your regular book buying a channel, which is going to be forthcoming. But I want to do a series of shows with you, Warren, on each of these 12 steps and how to manifest that, how to relate that to the addiction,
yes,
to the institutions of white, the racist institutions of white supremacy. And so I want you, ladies and gentlemen, to understand this is not a show about alcoholism. This is not a show about drug addiction. This is a show and a series about the addiction to white supremacy, the addiction to whiteness, and how to remove to train your brain to remove yourself from the effects of the racist institutions of white supremacy.
More importantly, how to change our reaction the racist institution and white supremacy, because that's the problem. We're so entrenched in, we have to respond this way. We're the only ones trying to play nice and trying to get along and cooperate and all these other things. And the system is not friendly to us. And so we have to change our reaction. We have to galvanize and become unified in different ways. And trust me, if we go through the steps and the exercises and you pierce your own life and do the chronicling that's required, it's not required that you show this to anybody else. You don't have to share it publicly. You don't need to go out and confess your sins, so to speak. It's about learning the things that we've done wrong to ourselves and learning how to change those behaviors. And once we start doing that, we'll begin to like ourselves better. And again, it doesn't take a lifetime to do that. And we'll start learning, going through the steps for me, at some point, I get to forgive myself for the things that I've done. I've been caught in the reactionary pattern of self-hatred and self-destruction and all of those other things. We have to change that from person to person, and that becomes a part of the collective.
Wow. I so appreciate you, my brother. You have no idea.
Okay. Thank you.
And so why don't you do this for me? Stick around with me in the green room.
Okay.
As we sign off, and we're going to take it to the next level and get some new dates set and have a continuation of this conversation.
Thank you and your audience for having me today. I appreciate it.
Absolutely, my brother. All right, everybody. You know what to do. Go and comment. Go and share this with everybody you possibly know that could use this information, that needs this information, which is pretty much everybody that is melanated. So I expect you to do your due diligence and do your job and share this with everybody that you know. And yeah, it's for black men, but it's also for black women, because until we as black men get ourselves together, we can't really help our black women and be the men that you want us to be and that we should be and are supposed to be. And so I'm just honored that we have some great, great minds and experts to be able to help us on that journey. We'll see all of you next time on the